right. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to First Things First, getting your cybersecurity news for the day so you can be able to kick major butt and just dominate the day, whether you're a practitioner or you're looking to get in the field or you're actually just kind of curious about what's going on in that, you know, in that space. You're going to get it here. My name's Gerry Auger. I do this every morning, and we're going to go through the top stories, and then I'm going to break and give you reflective analysis on each of those stories. I've been working in the field quite a long time, so I've got some opinions on it. Also, if you're new here, we got a great, great audience that's always engaging, so be sure to say good morning. I hope you all had a wonderful, refreshing, relaxing weekend. If you're a fan of pro football, perhaps your team won. Perhaps you have a rookie quarterback that plays like a rookie quarterback and you guys got smoked by the Buffalo Bills. That's an option that some of us are enjoying this lovely morning. But all said, it was a good weekend. And I hope everybody is feeling good. If you want to follow along, the stories that we're going to be going through are at CISOseries.com. David Sparks and his group, they put out a wonderful podcast, which is why I'm doing this show. I listen to this every morning, and I want to just share it with all of you. So good morning, Emmanuel. Good morning, Michael. Good morning, Ling. David Jones, always nice to see you. Professor Black Ops, what's up? Hopefully you guys got your coffee. I went with the tall boy today. It was a long weekend. I made dinner on Christmas Day, 4 hours in the kitchen. Loved it. Loved it. Loved it. Loved it.
I'm a crypto evangelist. I love it. Love it. Love it.
Yep. All right. So let's get into the morning news. Thank you very much. Let's go.
From the CISO series, it's Cybersecurity Headlines.
Hey, Stella. Abba Yomi.
It's Monday, December 27th, 2021.
Hey, Alexis.
Rook ransomware is yet another spawn of the leaked Babook code. A new ransomware operation named Rook, R-O-O-K, has appeared recently on the cybercrime space, declaring a desperate need to, quote, make a lot of money, end quote, by breaching corporate networks and encrypting devices. The Rook ransomware payload is usually delivered via Cobalt Strike, with phishing emails and shady torrent downloads being reported as the initial infection vector. Sentinel Labs has found numerous code similarities between Rook and Babook, which is a defunct ransomware as a service that had its complete source code leaked on a Russian-speaking forum in September of this year. The similarities include using same API calls to retrieve the name and status of each running service and the same functions to terminate them. Russia finds Google.
Okay, so this is no surprise, guys. Basically, whenever we see source code get leaked of a tool, no matter what it is, or a piece of malware, you can expect copycats to come out of the woodwork, right? Your approach to protecting from ransomware, your approach to protecting from ransomware shouldn't change. Your approach to detecting, responding, and be able to recover in a way that works for the business shouldn't change, right? What I'm getting out of this is there are more ransomware players in the pool, and quite frankly, it's a crowded pool. So this doesn't move my needle. What I do want to point out is that the Babook ransomware code was leaked online, and this is so much like Mirai years ago, if you remember. So basically, whenever somebody has to be smart enough to create the code, right? But then once the source code gets leaked, the level of difficulty for entry is reduced way, way down. Again, with Mirai, those two guys out in New Jersey who wrote it, they wanted to hide, so they released it publicly. And then we saw a mass proliferation of Mirai variants all over the place. They were thinking they could hide the noise. They didn't, and they were caught. But this is no different than that. Again, just so we're all clear, is a little bit of a technical thing. What they said in here is there's typically an initial infection vector through shady downloads, right? Hey, get a cracked copy of this video game, or get a free movie streaming, get the new Matrix 4 movie, like MP4, download here, right? That's how they get you. That's why you shouldn't be going to, like, you know, shady sites and downloading stuff and executing it. And then they're using Cobalt Strike for stage 2 payload, advanced persistence mechanisms. So make sure your EDR solutions and your tooling can detect Cobalt Strike. That might be something if you wanted to demonstrate to yourself and to your leadership that your this Rook thing isn't a big deal. You may want to, in a test machine, and run Cobalt Strike because you can get that or get a variant of it and see if your EDRs pick it up. Okay.
$100 million over illegal content. A Russian court issued the financial penalty on Friday in response to Google's alleged, quote, systematic failure to remove banned content, end quote. Although the financial penalty is the largest of its kind ever to be issued by a Russian court, it reportedly represents a mere 6.7% of the money Google made in Russia last year. Russian journalist Alexander Plushev speculated on social media that Friday's markedly significant fine, quote, may indicate that the political decision to expel Western services from Russia has been made, end quote. Google has been given 10 days to appeal against the penalty. The company's press service said it would decide whether to appeal after studying the court documents.
Okay, a couple things going on here from my perspective. One, Russia is has been known and seen to want to ban content from the internet. Okay, so banned content. Again, who gets to decide what banned content is? I'll tell you who gets to decide, the people in charge, right? And obviously, they're not going to ban stuff that is supportive of whatever their regime is, and they're going to suppress anything that is anti-establishment. Okay, I'm not saying that it's I'm not saying all the banned content is anti-establishment. I'm not saying it's all appropriate, right? I'm sure there's tons of inappropriate stuff there. Having said that, I haven't looked at the banned list, right? But another thing that comes to my mind right away, and I hate to be so cynical, is that if the fine was $100 million, and that's only 6.7% of what Google made last year in Russia, it makes me feel like this is Russia just forcing Google to pay to play, right? This 6.7%, while, you know, $100 million is a generation altering for me, for it being 6.7% of revenue of a company, it's not really that impactful. Like the average, you know, ransomware attack is around that much to a business, right? So I wonder if this is almost like, hey, you know, back alley, give me some money. No, all right, fine. We'll go through the front door with a fine that you'll pay and you'll continue working here. The story did allude to this is the beginning of this of the push out of Western technology inside these Eastern countries, but Google's way too powerful, right? And who doesn't want Google, right? And I know that DuckDuckGo is more privacy and stuff like that. I'm just saying the power of Google. So I see this maybe as more of a just a fine, a pay-to-play.
Fake Christmas Eve termination notices used as phishing lures. Ooh, a phishing campaign using a well-known malware family is employing a pair of particularly devious methods to trick targets into opening an infected file. Fake employee termination notices and phony Omicron variant exposure warnings. The suspicious email told the target that their employment would cease as of December 24th and that the decision was not reversible. An attached password-protected Excel file promised additional details. The emails deployed Drydex malware, which would be downloaded to the victim's computer from a Discord server and then begin stealing credentials.
BSEC, I think it was from revenue generated. This is cold, man. This is cold. So there's been a lot of recent news, right, where the Better.com guy fired 900 people over Zoom and it made a bunch of news. And then I want to say it was like CVS fired a bunch of people, seasonal workers, over Zoom, and it was a hot mess. So this is like very much in the news right now. For these people, these threat actors to send this letter to people, like, first of all, tip of the cap, like you are going to get people to click right through this and get and have them want to see this and to provide this obfuscated or, you know, fuzzed out file and having them have to run the macros, pretty clever, pretty sinister, frankly, but pretty clever. And it's, you know, basically just sending Drydex, which is like a financial credential stealing piece of malware. So I guess the takeaway for me on this one, folks, is bad guys. They're sometimes they're really bad. This is straight cold. But you know, make your end users educated. You know, whether it's Christmas Eve today or it's New Year's Eve tomorrow, or it's, you know, World Cup, Omicron variant, right? I'm sure that, remember there was a million COVID fishes at the beginning, and when the vaccinations were coming out, bad guys are going to use whatever is topical and socially relevant at the time, because their goal, their main objective is to get you to open and execute the payload in the email. And how do they get you to do that? They tag your interest. It's like, you know, a catchy thumbnail and title for a YouTube video. They're trying to clickbait you. So just make your end users aware of it.
Blister malware slips in unnoticed on Windows systems. Security researchers have uncovered a malicious campaign that relies on a valid code signing certificate to disguise malicious code as legitimate executables. One of the payloads that the researchers called Blister acts as a loader for other malware and appears to be a novel threat that enjoys a low detection rate. The threat actor behind Blister has been relying on multiple techniques to keep their attacks under the radar, the use of code signing certificates being only one of their tricks. Whoever is behind Blister malware has been running campaigns for at least 3 months, since at least September 15th, according to security researchers from Elastic. The threat actor used a code signing certificate that is valid from August 23rd and was issued by digital identity provider Sectigo for a company called Blist LLC with an email address from Russian provider mail.ru.
Okay, so this is a good one. I was kind of reading the story while it was talking. Couple things here. One, I guess what I would say is that the real takeaway here is thinking about how malware in general can evade security solutions and technologies, right? So if you're a compliance person and you're like, oh, well, do you have endpoint security? Oh, yeah, we've got, you know, what Microsoft Defender, EDR, or Cisco Secure Endpoint, EDR, whatever it is, Carbon Black, right? We have EDR. Okay, check. And this is where security doesn't equal compliance. This is a perfect example. So this particular piece of malware had a digital certificate, which allowed it to, you know, to be look like signed code. Valid to run in the environment. Okay. Now, a couple things that this particular piece of malware did that is interesting is it would embed itself into legitimate libraries, right? So when you're looking at what's executing, it would be, you know, already approved, already valid libraries. So the security tool isn't going to kick onto that. It then actually, where does it say it? Right. This is another common technique right here. I don't know if you guys can read that, but another common technique, because we have these automated sandboxes where we detonate malware all the time, this particular piece of code will sit dormant for 10 minutes. It will do nothing. So if you're going to analyze it, nothing's going to happen. You're going to think, oh, this is legit. This is fine. There's nothing here. Move on to the next thing. So A, it's not getting detected. B, if somebody manually to look at it, like me or you, it's not going to look like anything because most people don't. I mean, at least in my malware analysis experience, I don't wait 10 minutes. I go for the automated stuff. I'll maybe go 2-3 minutes and move on unless I'm going to do, you know, manual static analysis, which is a totally different skill set, right? Obviously, it says it's heavily obfuscated, which is just like, you know, par for the course as far as malware goes. But then it decrypts its payload, which it has inside of it, and it gets Cobalt Strike, which we just talked about. It is literally one of the preferred stage 2 payloads for threat actors because it's so good at what it does, which is allowing C2 traffic, data exfiltration, and persistence in the infected machine. What to wear for a cybersecurity interview? Endless mindset. If it were me, I mean, I dress professional, although in 2021, I don't wear a tie. So I wear a collared shirt. I'm also a male. So, I mean, I can't speak to what to wear if you're female, but I wear a blazer and a button-down shirt unbuttoned at the top, and I take a shower, shave, look good. Okay.
Ubisoft reveals player data breach came from user error. Ubisoft has admitted that data on some players may have been taken.
Hold on one second, guys. Looks like I may have missed a story in my... Excuse me. This is moderately unprofessional. I apologize in advance. As we were.
After a breach of its IT systems stemming from human error. The French gaming giant explained in a brief post that the misconfiguration of its IT infrastructure was quickly identified, but not before unauthorized individuals were able to access and perform a, quote, possible copy, end quote, of the information. Data stolen related to players of the wildly popular Just Dance game. Bluetooth enabled.
All right. Whatever. You know, I don't think Ubisoft's a good game developer personally, but I'm not going to beat him up over that in relation to this story. It's 2021. If you're a huge company like Ubisoft is, if you're an enterprise, if you're a Fortune 500 company, you probably have security incidents every single day. You probably lose some data, whether whether it's threat actors or it's, you know, Carl in HR who like leaves something in his car. It happens. I'm not saying it's right. I'm not saying I'm flipping about it. I'm just saying it's the status quo. It's the norm now. And it's more about, again, I got to get the shirts made up. It's more about resiliency than it is about security, where you're not stopping these things from happening. You're mitigating the impact when they do happen, because they're going to happen.
Home COVID test was cracked to fake results. Oh. Security vendor F-Secure has faked a COVID test result on a Bluetooth-equipped home COVID test. The firm tested the Ellume, E-L-L-U-M-E, COVID-19 home test, a device selected specifically because it uses a Bluetooth-connected analyzer for use with an app on your phone. Faked data produced by the Ellume unit was happily ingested by an outfit named Azova, A-Z-O-V-A, that certifies the results of COVID tests so that travelers can enter the U.S. F-Secure's post details a test in which one of its staff used the Ellume device to test for COVID, produced a negative result, but used the methods above to falsify the results. According to the Register, the vendor has since fixed the device.
Okay, I'm not going to get political on this thing. Keep it purely technical, okay? This seems like a pretty... This would actually be like a really fun security research project. Basically, this tool does home COVID testing, and it outputs a status result. You know, COVID or not COVID, pregnant, not pregnant, right? And it pipes the results to this approved third-party vendor, Azova, that will officially certify you as not having COVID and allow you admission into the United States. Well, apparently, and this is why it would be a fun little experiment, is because all you have to do is change the byte value at the very end of the status of the test. No, based on what I'm seeing here, it makes me think it's just a Boolean value, a one or a zero, a true or false, after all the processing and everything's done. So you just hook it at the end and overwrite the value, or, you know, if it's in code, it's like test equals function call of test, and then the next line you just insert a variable of the same name and set it to false, and it that's how that would work, right? As an example, I get it that it's maybe it impacts your travel plans, but come on. Like, I want to get through this as much as the next person. Why are we doing this? So anyways, Bluetooth, if you're looking at Bluetooth, if you're looking at wireless, grab PCAPs, grab traffic, look at what it is. And that's a fun way to kind of dabble into security research if you're interested in like a little side project screwing around with security. I will tell you that I haven't been to DEF CON in 2 years because of COVID, but like at DEF CON, there's always like five Bluetooth hacked talks, right? So, I mean, if you're looking to get a Bluetooth, if you're looking to get a DEF CON talk, like they're always interested in Bluetooth security research. Okay. I appreciate everybody chiming in on the appropriate attire for the interview for our friend Endless. Good luck on the interview too, or best wishes on the interview.
Capital One to pay $190 million settlement in data breach.
Whoa, that's a payday.
Capital
right
One
there.
Financial agreed to pay the sum to settle a class action lawsuit that customers filed against the firm after a hacker, purportedly a Seattle woman who had held a day job with Amazon Web Services, broke into its cloud computing systems and stole their personal information. In July 2019, Capital One announced data from about 100 million people in the U.S. had been illegally accessed. Federal authorities ultimately arrested Paige Thompson, a former Amazon Cloud employee living in Seattle, for breaking into the bank's server. While Capital One and AWS deny all liability, they chose to resolve the claims in the interest of avoiding the time, expense, and uncertainty of continued litigation. Jack.
Okay. You know, I don't know if you guys remember this story. This was like front page news a couple months ago. I feel like this woman, Paige, was kind of eccentric. I remember they threw her picture everywhere because it was a you know, kind of an eccentric looking photo, and they used her almost as a martyr. It makes me think of back in the early 2000s. If you guys remember when DCMA came out, and like they had like three people who were arrested and charged huge fines for illegally downloading music so they could have an example to wheel out in front of people. $190 million. Yeah. Again, this is one of those ones where it's a class action lawsuit. I feel very strongly about these things. Yes, you get restitution, but like you and I, Tom, me, Tom and Kay, we're each getting $7 from Capital One, and the lawyers are getting like $40 million. Right. So like, yes, but does it really do anything other than like get the lawyers rich? Like, is Capital One going to change their practices? Is this a significant impact to their business? Or is this just like they stroke a check and move on? Because, you know, I don't know. I've always been kind of cynical about class action lawsuits, if you even get paid. I remember I was in a class action lawsuit for Netflix or something like that, and it took like 7 years and I never got anything. So maybe I was hacked. All right. Oh, the next one's good. Here we go.
Dorsey blocked on Twitter by Mark Andreessen. The block comes after Dorsey criticized certain corners of the venture capital industry and made several specific remarks about the firm Andreessen co-founded, Andreessen Horowitz. This week, Dorsey has expressed multiple views on Web3, a potential new decentralized version of the internet based on blockchain. Perhaps most notably, the entrepreneur said Web3 would be owned by rich VCs like Andreessen instead of the people. Andreessen, by the way, was the co-inventor of the first widely used point-and-click web browser, which eventually became Netscape. Remember, we're...
So it says, blocked on Twitter. Not Jack Dorsey isn't blocked fully from Twitter, just from Mark Andreessen. You know, and whatever. The whole Web3 space is heating up. This is the metaverse, if you guys aren't familiar. Maybe some of you got... Oculus Quests for Christmas, or you got your family one. I have one, and I actually logged in yesterday, and like Meta, Facebook or whatever, they are pushing a couple apps that are like the immersion ones. Like one's called Spatial, and there's another one. It's the one that like Zuckerberg was showing off on the news with the different office room layouts and stuff like that. Yeah, there's a whole NFT, all that stuff. So I'm not surprised. I mean, whatever. You as an individual can block anyone on Twitter from messaging about messaging you and stuff like that. So this is only a story because Jack Dorsey was the CEO and founder of Twitter, and now he's being blocked because he's got some, you know, kind of anti-popular opinions. I do find it interesting. I will be obviously Web3 is huge, so I'm going to be kind of keeping my eye on it, following it. I am, you know, I'm a security professional, but I'm a technologist, engineer kind of mindset person. So this is really interesting to me. You're naive if you don't think that there's going to be a ton of money, like billions of dollars in Web3. And it makes sense that the people with money are going to be able to invest early and absorb losses and, you know, probably strike it rich, right? And control what's going on in there. The scary thing is it's no different than the internet. Like it's just a different meta. I hate to say that. It's a different format of the internet, right? So the same way people can control messaging and information and access and all these other things on the internet today is pretty much just going to overlay onto Web3. It's just that you're immersed as a person instead of clicking on a display, right? Going back for a second to this story really quickly, BSEC, you're absolutely right. It was insider threat. She was a contractor, I believe, for Capital One, abused all of her access, downloaded it, and then was wicked overt about having done it, which was another reason why it was so easy to make her an example and a martyr. So really quick, let me look through the chats here really quickly. Pedro, good to see you. You know, I really do appreciate it, Kevin. If you guys are watching on LinkedIn, YouTube, very, very happy to have you. I do stream to Facebook and Twitch, but I don't really do a lot to cultivate that area. So, I probably no one watching there, but that's okay. We've got our international friends. Hello from Brazil. Good to see you. I know we've got some Nigeria, some India, some UK, some Ireland, and, you know, of course, the United States up in here. I do want to share with you guys that if you are around this Thursday, on the Simply Cyber Thursday live stream, we will be having Craig Schultz and Mike Lyons in to talk about corporate cybersecurity risk. Now, before you roll your eyes and click away, listen, this is part of the entire program, right? Yes, 0 days and labs are cool, but like if you want to understand the overall scope of what's going on, this is a huge piece of it, especially as we decentralize our tech stacks and we bring in third-party SaaS providers and these type of things. This whole talk stemmed from the Kronos attack and how payroll was getting screwed for a bunch of people. I asked them if they wanted to come on and talk about that. As always, this is the Daily Cybersecurity Threat Briefing. First things first. Might change the name. I don't know. We'll see. But catch us over on Discord if you want to continue the conversation and engage with the community. As always, people, love having you. Love doing the morning briefings. I hope you're ready for the day. Y'all have a good one, and we'll see you.